finals. Come on, man. I'll go get my truck.
A little bit about me, background. You guys probably saw the attacker piece, so we'll get into a little bit of that. But I'm part of the Advanced Threat Countermeasures team for NUIX. What my group does is attack simulations, pen testing, and other advanced security services designed around helping people build up their security posture. So we help teams go from everything from I have no idea how I'm doing right now as far as security goes to come at me, bro. So basically, we do attack simulation based off whatever types of attacks that you're worried about, and emulate everything from APT style attacks to board kits. So if anybody here has, works with schools a lot, board kit attack factor is actually a thing. So I also do a lot of incident response work with our incident response team. I've worked on some books, and I've actually contributed code to a number of open source security projects. I do kind of both the high level stuff as far as security goes, but also go down deep into the protocol status. So what we're gonna be talking about is how to take advantage of testing that you may otherwise already have as far as pen testing, security auditing, those sort of things, to also help make sure that you're capable of responding to actual attackers. How many people here have security responsibilities? Awesome. So what we're gonna look at is how to, for maybe just a slight incremental cost, actually get a whole lot more out of the things that you're doing, and also kind of how to think about the stuff that you have coming at you and to help improve your ability to respond. And so we're going to start off talking a little bit about the security landscape, and then where I feel like we should be headed is world in order to try to help improve our ability to respond. What I've seen has worked really well, and then actually some stories, both successes and hopefully some humorous failures as well. So to start off with, it's morning, and morning hurts for me. I don't know about for you guys. So if you have questions, comments, random heckling, whatever, feel free to speak up. I think that having some interactive discussions is really helpful to making sure that everybody's engaged. So if you guys have any things that you have questions about along the way, feel free to speak up. So obviously you guys are familiar with what's going on in the news, cyber jihads, armies, creepy dudes in masks looking through what looks like a circuit board, and Russian mafia. I don't know if you guys have actually seen any pictures of the actual Russian mafia that do guarding, but most of the time they're wearing, for some reason, blue Adidas tracksuits. So I guess that's their official uniform. And then obviously China, which is, as soon as someone says it was an advanced attacker, everybody is like, oh, so China. And so when we look at what's actually hitting the news, everything from the Anthem breach, which was 80 million records, to things like Target, which everybody has seen, and the 70 million records there. One of the interesting things about that is the Target breach has made news for a lot of additional reasons as well, including that their breach insurance may not pay, and that they have been found liable. So there's gonna be class action lawsuits for that breach. So it's gonna be more than just hey, you have to pay for the 70 million records you lost. You're also going to have to pay for other stuff too. And so this one's going to be interesting. There's a couple others that are out there that are interesting right now. Home Depot, 56 million records breached. And at this point, cybercrime is more profitable than drug trade. And it, for a lot of situations, has a lot less risk than drug trading. The laws are different. Penalties are different, and so this is actually for some cases a lot easier and a lot less risky than doing drugs. Other big ones that we've seen, $4.5 million at CHS. And these are probably places that people in the room have shot that. I can neither confirm nor deny Dairy Queen. These nine breaches alone is 215 million records. And so that roughly equates to the population of these large cities. And so across all of these different nations, you know, the biggest cities, that is pretty much losing the records from all of those, or all of the citizens of all of those states. So when we really start looking at this, it's not just commercial entities that have to be worried. Obviously, you've got the OPM. Anybody here part of that? Yeah. So the OPM breach, 21 million records. Slowly they're releasing more and more about what got stolen. So first it was, you know, just everything about you. And now it's fingerprints and other information as well. And then the Ashley Madison breach, it was interesting to see, just make it a little bit more interesting for you guys, all the state and local government email addresses that were part of that. And that has whole other ramifications. I don't think that there's been a data breach before that's led to suicides, right? And so the question is, are these guys going to become liable? They promised record deletion, they promised lots of other things. And so since they have failed to meet those promises, I think the lawsuit for this one is going to be even more scary. And that was 40 million records. So when you actually look at the costs, costs are continuing to go up. And so $217 per record. And the average cost of a data breach is $3.79 million. Obviously it's a lot easier to include the prevention in the budget than the response. That's one of the things that we're trying to help people with, is figure out how to deal with this. How many people have some kind of breach insurance for their area? Awesome. So the insurance companies now are, there's due diligence clauses in your insurance. For people who are getting breach insurance, one of the things insurance companies are doing is forcing proof of due diligence afterwards. So if you can't prove that that you've been doing due diligence, they may actually turn down your policy claim, which means you both paid for something that they may not actually reimburse you for, and you still have to deal with the aftermath. So just generally, what have we learned from this? Companies, government, everybody else still getting breached, right? It's actually kind of interesting. Any more people aren't judged by whether or not they're compromised. It's the media response to whether or not they're compromised. And so the PR piece of breach response is actually more important publicly than what you actually did to fix the original problem. And so this is kind of, I think, interesting. And what we're doing in general still isn't enough. One of the things that I think is serious is we're constantly tracking what attackers are doing. And so then we're fixing what they're doing right now, right? Which means they are always ahead of us. We're always playing catch up to whatever the bad guys are doing. And as far as prevention and being aggressive, we think about things like antivirus and those kind of things. But antivirus for emerging threats hasn't been effective for 10 years, right? When you start looking at some of the other things, they haven't been effective for the last 5 or 6 years. Firewalls aren't enough. And so we've got to figure out how to stay ahead of what the attackers are doing in order to make sure that what they're doing right now is caught, but also that we have the ability to detect what's going to happen in the future as well. And so we don't have crystal balls, but we can go through and we can figure out some ways to help identify the types of things that attackers have to do during an attack, and identifying those activities proactively, which regardless of what techniques they're using, those sort of things will generate alerts that we can actually do actions on. So obviously, if you keep doing things the same way, you'll get the same results. And there's a lot of talk about tradition, or that's not how we do things here, which I think is super dangerous, especially when you're talking about defense, right? Whether it's the best defense is a good offense, or if you keep doing the same thing, if a football play happens the same way every time, it's pretty easy to figure out how to get around it, right? So we want to make sure that we're not doing the same thing, and that we're breaking the traditional way of doing stuff and looking at what's next. So does anybody have questions about any of the first part? Comments? Okay. So here's what I think we really need to start moving away from. And that's security through compliance. Compliance is designed to be the bare minimum, right? But people are considering that to be due diligence, right? So if you're just doing that bare minimum is barely enough to actually be able to keep people from downloading malware, from actually keeping critical systems segregated. And as anybody who's gone through a compliance audit knows, most of those are very kind of wiggle work. You can explain away a lot of things. And so when you start looking at security through compliance, it's super dangerous because you're not actually trying to have a strong security posture, you're trying to make sure all your checkboxes are checked. Security through reliance on products. For whatever reason, it's always easier to get capital expenditures than it is to get people and resources that you need to do the things, right? And so, everybody says, okay, so we've got an appliance that will take care of this. So who's gonna run that appliance? Who's gonna look at the alerts? Who's gonna deal with the aftermath, remediation, those sort of things? It's easy to get the little box that does the thing, but it's hard to get the people that have the time to look at the thing. The number of times when I come in and talk to people, and I'm like, so do you have things like SIM? They're like, yes. I'm like, so what are you doing with it? And their answer is, well, nothing. It was really noisy, so we've got one. And so just because you have the resources to buy something doesn't necessarily mean that it's actually providing the value. Lack of ability to respond. On the credit card side, one of the things I think is most interesting is most of the time companies don't realize they've been breached. They actually get what's called a CPP, or a common point of purchase, from the credit card companies and says, hey, you've been identified as a place where lots of people who've had fraudulent activity on their card have shopped. You are now required to have a PCI forensic audit. So for those, people usually charge anywhere from $300 to $600 an hour for that response. And so regardless of who figured it out, you still are gonna have to have those people on site trying to figure out what happened. The worse your logging is, the worse logs that exist, and the harder it is to get to the systems that were impacted, the more that's gonna end up costing. And so the key here is limiting the amount of time from compromise to mitigation. And so to do that, you've got to have fast detection and then the ability to actually do the things that need to be done to stop the attacker, right? So another one is lack of visibility. How many people feel like they have great visibility into what's going on in their enterprise? That's awesome. that's usually, very few people feel really confident about that. And it's because, what do you log? Who has time to figure out all of that? How do you categorize what things need to be bubbling up? How do you know what traffic is supposed to be there? And the OPM breach, I think, was particularly interesting. Does anybody know how they figured out that they'd been breached? A vendor came in with a toy and said, just let us set it up for you and see what it finds. So they didn't have visibility into what was going on. Vendor set up the tool. Within a couple hours, and identified malicious activity exfiltrating data. So they didn't have that visibility before. As soon as that tool was there, they had the visibility to actually know that they'd been breached. but they still, I don't think, had figured out everything that's been exfiltrated. First, they were like, just some personal data, just a couple hundred thousand records, maybe millions, you know, whatever. And now they're fingerprints. Who knows what else they'll find out? And you know, completely like, I don't know anything about anything. But if you have the ability to get records out of something, you usually have the ability to put records in. And so, for a government clearance database, it seems like that might be a competitive advantage as well. So who knows what we'll find next, right? So another one's too much noise from systems. How do you tune the stuff so that you just care about, you just see what you care about? One of the biggest complaints we hear from event management tools is, you know, it's just too noisy. I don't even know what any of this stuff means. And so making sure that you actually have the ability to understand what you need to care about from the systems and figure out how to filter your alerts and how to bubble the stuff up that really matters to the top. And I think that this is probably the biggest one. How many people have training problems? I think a lot of people are just too tired to read. Because pretty much I think everybody has training issues. Whether it's getting the budget to get enough training, having the right people who you can get training to, those sort of things. Having the right staff is critical to being able to respond to incidents, whether it is, you know, IT outages or whether it's, you know, actually being attacked. And so I think that, you know, we need to be focusing on getting the right staff in, and I'm sure we're going to require here, you know, but I think that it's important for more people hear this. Hopefully the more people will talk about it, and then it'll get to a point where the people who need to hear it will hopefully make the decisions. And the hardest part is, you know, IT is a cost center. It's not something that generates revenue. And so talking to people who have the money on this is hard. But, you know, when you start looking at prevention versus response dollars, it's crazy off balance. And you're talking about possibly millions of dollars for response, or, you know, a little bit for salary every year in order to help make sure you've got the right people trained. So we need to get staff experienced in dealing with breaches before they're actually dealing with the breach. How many people here deal with incidents on a regular basis? Okay. So for people who are dealing with these, there's a lot of different ways that people are dealing with breaches. So making sure that they're trained to deal with them quickly, effectively, and in a timely enough period that they can actually minimize the damage is really important. And so another one's getting them the visibility to make the decisions that they need to make. So if they don't have that sort of visibility, it's impossible to make good decisions. And so also being able to regularly exercise the skills. So actually understanding what you're supposed to do, doing it right, doing it wrong, all of those things. And all of this is kind of like war games, right? How many people have any kind of military background? Some people are more razy-handy about that than anything else. That's awesome. And opposing forces exercises are critical, right? Train as you fight. Make sure that when you're going through and training, you're in the same situations that you're going to be in when you're actually in the battlefield, to make sure that all of this is rote memory, that you know exactly what to do. You've made these decisions before, and this isn't something that's fresh and you're having to research and, you know, who do I call, what do I do, who do I talk to? So these opposing forces exercises are critical. So and make sure that you have the experience to do the right thing. This should be almost rote memory by the time you actually have a real incident. And so experience is critical, right? I'll let you guys process that, because that is just a whole mess right there. But I think that everybody will agree that making mistakes is actually a much better learning tool than doing the right than making the right decision first. Because you have to learn about what didn't work, what you have to do to change it. And a lot of the time, if you just follow a playbook, you never know why you're actually doing some of those things. So being able to actually go through these processes and have different scenarios happen and have good responses and bad responses And then being able to do the post for those and figure out what worked and what didn't is critical to growth. So let's get into some of the details. So getting started. So the first one is getting the right controls in place. When we talk about controls, we're talking about both technical controls and policy controls. And the thing that is interesting is super easy to write policies. Making policies that are enforceable is something completely different. If you have policies and you can't actually tell whether or not people are following them, those aren't enforceable policies. And so just because you have them, you also have to make sure that there are things that you can detect when those policies have been compromised. And so you got to keep everything under control. So how do we do this? Well, I think that the best way is iteratively, right? It's impossible to go from, you know, well, this is a mess, to, all right, we're 100% completely secure at one time, right? We have to pick the things that we can do to make stuff better. So step one is identify where you're at, right? Until you actually know where you're at, it's impossible to know where you're headed. So identify security posture, identify the gaps, set a strategy for dealing with those gaps, implement it, and then for anybody who has done the basic, identify the gaps again. So you go back and start this process over again. And so you stop when you feel like you have the security posture that you can actually detect when things are happening. And so that doesn't necessarily mean that you can respond at this point, but you at least know that you have logs, you have alerts, you have all of these things. So when we're pen testing, this is typically how people improve their security posture. We come in, we say, all right, here's the gaps that we found, and here's the strategic things you need to do. A lot of people, this is very scary, because they say, all right, so what do I have to buy to fix this, right? Most of the things that we find are zero cost fixes. They're people time, but if you actually have the right people advising you, they're actually fairly small people time. Most of the time is in test, not in implementation. And so the things that we can do for free with the technologies we already have in place are usually crazy more impactful than the things that you actually have to buy a new device to implement. Whether it's disabling protocols that you don't need, that give away information about your organization, to making sure that you have the right domain policies for Active Directory, to make sure that people can't do things that they shouldn't be able to, protecting passwords, making sure that you're resilient to phishing, those sort of things. Those aren't particularly expensive things to fix. Those are things that take some people time, and those are people that takes things that take some actual time because they require some training in some areas, and they also require sometimes shifts in culture, right? So one of the things that I think is most interesting is a lot of people are, when you start talking about security, are very concerned about the organizational culture. How does, you know, people won't accept, actually people won't accept, you know, why. But it turns out that, you know, when the public comes and says, so why did all the records go away? Well, people didn't feel like changing. It isn't really something that's particularly newsworthy. And so you have to make sure that you're balancing those things. We want people to be able to get work done. We want them to be able to do it securely. And there is definitely a balance there. And so that is what I spend a lot of my time on, is making sure that people can get the things they need done, but do it in a way that's minimally impactful to them, but greatly impactful to the posture of the organization. So okay, you've got security controls, you've got policies, everything's awesome, right? Well, just because we have the tools and we have the logs doesn't really mean we have any idea about what's going on. And so you actually need a way of getting meaning out of that data. And we're talking about visibility, right? We need to be able to see where we're going and what we've got to make the decisions we need to be able to make in a quick period of time to know when something does happen, what's happened, how we need to respond to it, right? And so visibility is critical. So what do we do? Centralized logging. I think that's kind of everybody's like, duh, right? Centralized logging. I think the other piece of that is getting the right logs. SIM solutions, people watching the alerts, So I think that more people have SIM than they have people watching the alerts, which is kind of interesting. But making sure that actually the things that you have are being looked at. And then the right logging. I think that is probably one of the hardest things to do. And so understanding what you need to be looking for, what are the indicators of different types of attacks, how that plays together. One of the things that my team does is sit side by side with people while we're doing pen testing, so we can actually do compromises. They can see what that looks like in log files, and they can look at what those alerts are. And what it turns out is most of the people have no idea why certain things fire or what the actual activity is that generates these alerts. They just know that certain things look bad or certain things don't look bad. Target, for instance, they actually saw the alerts from their compromise. They dismissed them because they didn't understand what they meant. So if you're not actually doing some side-by-sides, actually looking at what's generating the alerts that you're seeing, how do you know what you should care about? How do you know what's an indicator that somebody is escalating privileges on a system or moving horizontally across your network? When we're going through and doing pen tests, from the point where we get a single credential to the point where we have compromised the entire organization is usually about 2 to 3 hours. And so that's like we got the secretary's credential to we have full control of the entire domain, 2 to 3 hours. So unless you can look at this data and make decisions within that time period, you're in a Sony situation. What happened with Sony? So they got compromised, people had pervasive access to the network, and it took them months to get to a point where they could actually get people out of that network. And so that is a crazy expensive venture, figuring out how to control the bleeding and actually stop people who have pervasive access to your network is incredibly difficult. And so we have alert data, right? So awesome, we're 100% set. Well, it turns out, not quite. So you actually have to be able to do incident response. How many people actually have or do incident response practice drills? How many of those are include things like media relations and external legal counsel and those sort of things? So when we start talking about incident response, there's actually a lot to that. Most folks, when they're talking about incident response, I would say the vast majority of organizations, incident is we have a piece of malware, re-image and carry on, right? And in this day and age, that's actually fairly dangerous because one of the things we see when we're actually have to be brought on site for broad scale incident response is that the machines that were part of the original compromise have been re-imaged. And we say things like, do you have a backup? It's usually met with snickering. And so that's a horrible situation to be in. Whether it's, can we have logs? And they say, well, we have logs for the last 3 days, and the compromise happened 4 months ago. Our ability to get anything useful out of that is very, very unlikely. And so if machines have been re-imaged without any sort of triage data being gathered or images being gathered before they're re-imaged, you're kind of in trouble. I heard some people talking about CryptoLocker earlier, and this is the same thing with CryptoLocker. Oh, this machine has a piece of malware on it, let's re-image it. Oh, it also had CryptoLocker on it, and now a quarter of the organization has encrypted files. So backups would have been good probably before this happened, so what are we going to do now? Well, you re-image the only possible way of getting that information back, so where are you at now? Right, so the re-image method is more and more dangerous. So we obviously need something more mature. And this practice incident response, I think it's critical to making sure that this works well. One of the things that we help people with is once you've got the security posture, once you've got the visibility, actually testing to make sure that incident response is working the way it's supposed to. One of my favorite stories from actual pentest was we were on site with an organization, and I had compromised their domain and added a new domain admin account. So they actually had alerting for when domain admins get added. So it was right before lunch, and they got the alert. And the person whose account that I used to create it was apparently already out of lunch. He went for early lunch. So I was sitting on the other side of the wall from the sysadmins, and I heard somebody go, "Hey, how did Bob create that account from his phone? Huh, we should ask him when he gets back." So an hour later, they kind of hung out to ask him when he got back. They said, "How did you create a domain admin from your phone? Do you have like a remote desktop client or something?" And he goes like, "What do you mean I haven't done anything?" And I go, "Huh, should we tell somebody?" And I said, "Well, I don't know. Do we have an incident response plan? I'm not sure. Where would we find it?" And so then I hear them looking through their intranet, looking for the incident response plan. So at this point, I actually asked the security guy to come over and sit with me while they're discussing for the next hour whether or not they should tell somebody, first of all, that a random new domain admin has been added to the organization. And secondly, whether or not that there's anything that they're supposed to do about it. Whether they just delete it and move on, or do they tell somebody about it, what they do. So in the period of time that this discussion was going on, I actually compromised their enterprise data warehouse, and I had full access to that. So finally, the head of the security went over and asked them, "Hey guys, how's it going, what's up?" And they asked him, "So we see a new domain admin created, we didn't do it, should we tell somebody?" And so that was a very interesting discussion. It turns out, unless people have actually practiced this stuff and actually seen how all of this is supposed to play out and have failed doing it once, then there's a lot of reasons why they may not know what to do when it really matters. And like I said, that hour that they spent talking about it was the difference between all of the data in their enterprise going away and them being able to successfully mitigate that attack. So we need that practice and instant response. And so, otherwise, you may be left with your pants down, even if you do have a strategic team. I have no idea what happens with SWAT there, but that's just kind of a mess. So, building a response, investing in people. So this is people training, this is in exercises, this is in all of that stuff. Investing in people is critical. And it's, you know, it really is. Failure to plan is really planning to fail. So building up your instant response, internal contacts. How many people here have HR as part of their instant response plan? It seems kind of strange, but when you start talking about, well, potentially personal data from the company is from the organization's at risk. So HR systems, PeopleSoft, those kind of things. So that's kind of a big deal for HR. But also, when you start looking at how did this stuff originate, and you have to start writing reports on it, how do you deal with that in a way that's not violating people's policy privacy? So for instance, if someone was looking at maybe websites that they shouldn't, and that was the original entry vector, how do you deal with that as part of incident response? Obviously, writing the report that says, well, Bob hadn't been looking at whatever Bob was looking at, this wouldn't have happened, and that being the root cause. Everything from that to maybe somebody actually needs to be let go because you determined that they were actually purposefully stealing data. So all of that is critical. Internal and external PR teams. So being able to send out emails about what happened. Emails about emerging attack trends. So for instance, if people are being part of an active phishing campaign to try to get access to certain resources, being able to get that information out in a meaningful way, and having people who are briefed on the security side of stuff so that you don't have to start off the conversation with your internal and external communication people of, so here's what cyber is, right? Because this needs to be something that they already have an idea. And they also need to be able to write about it without sounding crazy. That's important as well. And then externally, most of the time for breach investigations, when we are engaged just by external counsel, because at that point, everything that we find is privileged. And so it's part of instant response. If somebody comes after any individual entities legally, then what is discoverable changes. So I know as part of government, you guys have some slightly different hierarchy than most companies have for legal. But for like stuff going on in South Carolina, that kind of stuff, they still engage external legal counsel to do a lot of their stuff. So unless that discussion's been had, and unless you actually have plans there, finding a lawyer in short time period, and finding a forensics company in a short time period are really hard. Finding the right PR company on a short term is almost impossible. And it turns out that the things that people are saying because they didn't have PR on board before a breach are costing them crazy amounts of money. Because at that point, the things that you say can directly be admissible into court. And so what we're seeing is the things that people are responding as part of post-breach press announcements and things like that are being brought into court and are showing that they actually didn't have the right things in play. And they actually, the trend is to understate the impact and overstate the level of sophistication of the attacker. In a lot of cases, by doing that, when the actual evidence comes out, it is further proof that you either not done due diligence or you didn't actually have the visibility required to be able to detect a threat. So, using threat simulation to determine incident response engages. Once you actually have a security posture that you're comfortable with, one of the things that we basically do is unannounced testing. So if we come in and act like an actual real attacker, your incident response plan should kick off. Those people should all be engaged. And you should actually be looking at, okay, so what do we do now? And that kind of opposing forces exercise, obviously we want at least one person in the organization to know what's going on so that I would not do well in jail. So we want to make sure that like there is notification done. But one of the things we do is sometimes every quarter for an organization, we'll come in and we'll cause an incident. And then at that point, it doesn't matter if it's the busiest time, a downtime, whatever, making sure that they can respond to that is critical. Just because it's Christmas and people are out doesn't mean that that's not when attackers are going to hit. We see this happen all the time. Best time to hit? The night before Thanksgiving, right? Because people have a Friday off. You've got Wednesday night, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and then a very sleepy Monday in order to do whatever you're going to do. And so that's attackers are going to attack in that time period. Why? One, they've got those days off, right? And since you have those days off too, they've got plenty of time to do whatever they're going to do. But also, obviously, the more time they have to do whatever they need to do, you're going to be inundated with alerts on Monday. And so sorting through those may just be a click away, right? Maybe you don't feel like dealing with that Monday morning. And so maybe you'll just quickly approve those. And for the most part, for data breaches of massive amount of information, you have two different methodologies. You have the smash and grabs, which I call like the SQL injection on a website where somebody comes in, steals all your credit cards, and leaves. That's kind of like a smash and grab, right? It doesn't matter how loud and noisy it is, you've got the stuff and you're gone. And then there's people who want to stay low and slow because information is going to gradually accumulate over time, and they want to be able to exfiltrate that over longer periods of time. So picking some time when people are watching less is a great time to come in. Now, whether that's because we're under a DDoS attack, you know, we don't have time to deal with these other incidents, or whether that's because it's Thanksgiving, the poor one person who is IT duty on that day is just not having any of it. All of those things are great ways to get your initial attacks sort of under the radar so that you can maintain access for longer. Let's see what I'm doing on time. So another one is just making sure your incident response is effective. So just because your incident response plan kicks in doesn't mean that it is actually working. We had one test that was sort of intense basically what had happened was the sysadmins were super unhappy we were there. It turned out that they had somehow overstated the sophistication of their controls to the security team. And I kind of knew it was going to be a mess when we did the initial kickoff discussion. And the security team says, so here's the controls we have in place. And as they started listing the controls, you would see the sysadmins get together and probably go, well, that's not exactly true. And so the security folks just kept looking at me and going, okay, what do we do here? And so when we left the room and we started doing testing, all of the sysadmins were huddled around one person's workstation. They had upped logging on everything to see exactly what we were doing. So it turns out that just being able to see what's going on doesn't mean you have any ability to stop it. So they couldn't unplug our workstation or actually stop our network connection from working because that would kind of come across as a little petty. So instead what they were doing is they were making sure that anything we got access to, they tried to kick us off right away. Most of the access we got was from configuration problems, and so we weren't actually accessing systems. And we were able to escalate and get the administrator's local password for one of the systems, which was the same local administrator password for all of the systems. So at that point, we were able to quickly and automatically go through the entire organization and grab everybody's credentials and memory, including the domain admins that were actively watching us. So at that point, we looked to see who had access to the most things, and we picked the person who had the most access, because that's what you do, right? If you want access to everything, you pick the person with the most access. It turns out that was the guy's workstation that they were at. And so as we used his account to start moving from things to things, he noticed us logging in to change his password. At that point, we'd already compromised a domain controller, and we're sitting on the domain controller. So every time he changed his password, we had it again. And so we kept using this credential because it was the credential we needed to actually get access to stuff. And so this escalated into basically a full-blown temper tantrum. The only way that they could figure out to get us off of the domain controllers was to unplug the domain controllers, which actually led to an IT outage at that point, which obviously people ask, so what's going on? So we had already been in a conference room sort of giving the lunchtime brief as to how everything was going. And at that point, the guy came in with, these guys crashed our systems. Well, somehow the machines lost power and came back up. And so the security people said, well, they've been in here for the last hour, so probably not. Figure out what else happened. And so then the guy just went, stop using my password. And we're like, well, you actually have access to the thing that we were asked to get access to, and you're the only person, so we have to use your credentials. And then tears and stomping and yelling started, and it was claimed that we were just being mean to him. So from that point, which that was the first actual like tears and stomping I've ever had during a pen test. But a lot of the time people are pretty hostile about the things that you find. I mean, you guys all work very hard to keep your systems where they're at. When somebody comes in and says, well, you know, there's some things here that are missing, it's very easy to take it as that's not good enough, right? But what we're really saying is, you know, here's the justification for you to ask for more people, more training, all of that stuff. That's what we're providing. We're providing the justification for you to get the things that you need to be more successful. And I think ultimately everybody wants to be successful. And so getting those things will help improve lots of stuff. First of all, you'll have to deal with fewer incidents. You'll be able to get the resources you need to see the things you need to be able to see. And in a lot of cases, build up resiliency in systems that you wanted to build up resiliency in all along and just actually haven't had a piece of paper that you can show somebody that proves that you need it. Right, you can write business cases all the time for why stuff's important. But when somebody comes in and says, you know, we were able to hack and steal all the stuff, and here's why, and here's what you need to do to fix it, you can go and look and say, external validation, they were able to get our stuff, and they said if we do these things, then it'll be harder. That's really important. Being able to make sure that it's effective. So obviously these guys had great visibility. They knew everything I was doing, but they didn't have any ability to stop it. So making sure that your incident response, when it does kick off, actually has the ability to mitigate an attack quickly is critical. So that's having the right tools in place to be able to stop ports from being active quickly, identify where traffic's coming from. All of those kind of things are the things that are going to help stop the attack before it gets to the point where it's somebody is pervasively in an organization and you can't get them out. So obviously missing tactical response is a problem as well. So I don't know if you guys, can you guys read the bottom? The French military battle manual doesn't cover what to do when you don't have a weapon to drop. So once you've actually got things to where you're kind of happy with it, what we've seen be really effective is just doing regularly unannounced tests. That will make sure that you have the right people engaged, right? When you actually have an incident, you call the right people into the room, you make sure that they all are at least understand why they're there, they understand what everybody's doing, they understand what their roles are, and you can actually play this out. And so, as part of this, we also want to see if the response is timely and effective. If you can't stop me from doing my attacks, which in most cases when I'm doing pen tests, people don't even know I'm there. If you can't see me, if you can't stop me, then you don't have the ability to effectively respond to a breach. And so we tune that response and we do it again. So this is whether it's actually having attackers sit with your incident response people and say, look, I'm doing this. Here's what you need to do to stop it. Let's put this control in place. Look, this doesn't work anymore. Okay, let's take it away. So when something bad happens here, this is what we do to stop it. And then actually practicing it. And the practice is absolutely huge. I find this myself as a director, I am slowly becoming a little less technical than I was at one point. And so I have to go back periodically and make sure that I'm still up to date on all of the things that I do on the tech side, because just a couple months out of doing something, suddenly it's a lot harder, right? So making sure that this is happening at sort of regular intervals is important. And so these are actually much smaller exercises. You can do these maybe in a day and actually have fairly inexpensively somebody come in, do an attack, see what gets picked up, make sure that you're actually responding to it and actually running those drills. This is also true of DR. How many people run DR exercises? Yeah, I think most people usually run more DR exercises, but if you're not running DR exercises, this is also something that plays into this. Incident response, disaster recovery, business continuity, all of those things need to be tested. The number of times when I've heard, yes, we have a backup, what do you mean the backup doesn't work? Those things are absolutely insane. If you have backups of systems and you've never actually tried to restore them, you don't actually have backups of systems, right? We want to make sure that has been practiced and actually tested. So with the last chunk of time, hopefully nobody's actively asleep right now. So does anybody have questions or comments? Anything else? Yes, sir.
Most of your pen testing, is that done externally in that amount of time that you specified? So I think most of the time you said that you were able to gain access in a matter of a couple hours. So is that started externally, or are you already starting externally?
We actually do both. So when we start looking at what attacks are going on right now, almost all of them are starting with a phishing attack, right? And so that phishing attack has, how many people here, obviously, well, we'll just say everybody, has had malware on one of their systems, right? That is a vector in. What we usually do is add a malware backdoor to an example and either steal credentials or get somebody to run a piece of malware. And then it gives us access to the enterprise. So from there, we typically go on site or actually drop an appliance in their network that emulates a compromised machine. The reason we do that is because nobody wants to pay for the time that it would cost us to continue to tunnel over the internet to a machine who has no idea what the actual status of that machine is, maybe reboot it every night. We've got malware on it, so it'll keep coming home to us. But nobody wants to do with that. So once we've actually proved we can get in, then we can actually go and do on-site, that sort of thing, which reduces the amount of time it takes to do the testing. All the same sort of things happen, and the initial escalation things happen in the same time period. What takes longer to happen when you're doing it remotely is identifying data that may be at risk. And the data, one of the things that I like to talk about when we talk about security is security is actually an emotional thing, right? Security is, it's hard to measure, right? But you feel secure about stuff. So one example that I like to give for this is, if you're in your house, you feel pretty secure, right? A lot of people get baby monitors so that they can watch their baby, and they feel like, you know, everything is so much more secure. Now we can watch the baby, we can listen to the baby, we know when the baby's awake, asleep. That's all well and good until you hear somebody talking to your baby over the baby monitor. Anybody see this in the news? A number of people's baby monitors were getting hacked. And they were able to see into the baby's room and talk to the baby. 2 minutes before that and 2 minutes after that, your feeling of security is drastically different. Did your security posture change? No. But the way that you feel about it changes. And so by being able to show the impact of a compromise, which is we're able to get credit card data, we're able to get personal information. What I used to do when I was doing corporate security is I would steal my boss's password and show him different ways about, here's how this impacts you. And that was way more effective than talking to him about things that might happen because XYZ patch is missing. If I showed him how it impacted him personally, then that was much more impactful. You know, he couldn't tell that something was going on. He couldn't tell that when I sent him an email, it was actually something completely different. But as soon as he clicked on it, and I came in the office and I'm like, so that's a screenshot of your desktop, then that's immensely personal, right? And so we have to make sure that we are making the right cases to people to make those emotional decisions to give us the resources we need. And so that time it takes to find the data and to show exactly what can happen, that's really the critical time period that you get out of a pen test. All of the other stuff is also really important, testing instant response, all that kind of stuff. But getting the big thing that shows people that this really does matter, that is also great. Great question. Yes, sir.
Yeah, two questions. First is pretty small staff. What would be the most important area to focus on as far as security, like whether it be routing security or like server security? Where should we focus if we can't cover the whole gamut?
For most organizations, most of their stuff is Windows-based, right? So I would say making sure that your security around your Windows domain, workstations, and mobile assets are probably the biggest impact. People need a way into your organization. Most people have firewalls pretty well covered, right? When we start looking at how people are getting in, it's via compromised systems, so malware on workstations, those sort of things. Making sure that people aren't running as administrator, making sure that you actually have sufficient security policies so that whitelisted applications maybe are the only ones that can run on certain systems. Web browsing not being allowed from critical systems. All of those kind of things are policies that can be pushed out with Active Directory, which you can actually, for almost zero cost, have a fair amount of impact on the integrity of the laptops, on the systems in the organization. So, along the same lines, I mentioned that the organization where the little temper tantrum happened, they have the same local administrator password on every workstation, right? So coming up with a way to randomly generate passwords for local administrators means one system compromise doesn't lead to an organizational compromise, right? Those kind of things and locking down Windows environments so it's strong is a good starting point. And a lot of those things are basically free.
Okay. And the second part of my question that kind of rolls into it. You've got, you know, everybody here as council members and mayors and whatnot, everyone, we seem to be going more towards the mobile and people taking their stuff around. When we first started doing iPads, we implemented a password policy. Well, that password policy didn't work because the city council member couldn't see and didn't like having to type the password every time. So we went down to just a PIN number, which is less secure. And then in some cases, we even like this to devices where they didn't have to use any security.
Hello?
I know that's not good, but how do we enforce, or how do we get around that, or how do we secure that in the back where it needs to be?
So that actually goes really well back to the emotional discussion, right? It didn't feel, the council person didn't feel like that was really a problem, right?
Right.
So that's the sort of thing that you guys have heard the term FUD, right? Fear, uncertainty, and doubt. The reason it's so effective in security is because fear is a great motivator, right? So obviously, if it's his device that's compromised or her device that's compromised that leads to broad-scale news coverage, that's probably going to be problematic for re-election. So being able to have those discussions about what the impact of that is critical. So your device, you know, whether it's building up static statistics around, you know, looking at what applications are on there. I see you play Candy Crush. Did you know that installing malicious applications has the ability to lead to organizational compromise? Or if your iPad is stolen and you have a weak PIN, all of the emails that you have in your email box are suddenly exposed. People have the ability to send out emails as you, including press releases, whatever else. That can be a personal attack against them. And you know, they may say things like, well, I'll never lose my iPad, but you can ask Veteran Affairs, who has lost laptops accidentally because they've been left places, what the impact of that was. And it was millions of dollars and lots of embarrassment and lots of people being fired. And so having those sort of conversations about what the actual impact is, I think is really important. And then the other piece is, write down those impacts and have them sign off that they accept that risk. Because when it does happen and somebody says, well, you accepted the risk, and they go, well, I had no idea what that meant. You have in writing that they knew exactly what that meant. And them signing that piece of paper that says, I accept that risk, is actually a huge emotional jump for them, because that means they have to take responsibility. Right now, if it gets compromised, the IT people didn't protect me. If you have given them that list and they've signed off on it, you have done your due diligence in telling them what the risks are, they have made that decision, and at that point, it's completely on them. Right, and so I think that that little signature piece is actually fairly huge. Other questions? Okay.
What about a two-factor authentication? Is that really as secure as it sounds?
So two-factor authentication, especially for external stuff, is a lot more secure. One of the things that, like I said, we're seeing a lot of is initial attack vectors being phishing. So people put their credentials in onto a website, and everything from like OWA to actual VPN access is being used to get access into an enterprise. What we'll see is a lot of the time people use OWA as the first thing they go to, dump the global address book, and once you have that global address book, you can start sending targeted emails to people, which means it's much more likely to be successful because it actually comes from inside the organization, doesn't have a funky email address. You know, all of the typical things that people look for validity checks are going to kind of hit on first pass. And so then those people are going to be additional credentials that you can get. The more credentials you have, the better chance you have of getting pervasive access. And so using that to get into other systems, have people download malware, all of those kind of things, that is usually the first jumping point. And so limiting the impact of somebody giving away credentials for external resources is huge. Obviously, big culture change though, right? I found that the thing that is easiest is people, you know, getting a text message that has their second factor with it. That's pretty quick, and people saying you have to keep your cell phone with you is much easier than you have to know where your keys are at all points. I don't know about anybody else, but finding my keys some days is a little tougher than finding my phone. It's usually with me no matter what. And so actually doing two-factor authentication through phone seems to be a lot easier. And the other thing is, since banks and World of Warcraft are doing it, it's a lot more familiar with people, I think, now than it was a couple years ago. Any other questions? Cool. Thank you guys very much for your time. I'm going to be sticking around. And if you have anything else, please feel free to stop by and chat.